At least 180 of the high-ranking police officials who submitted courtesy resignations last month have so far been screened by the panel tasked to review their possible involvement in illegal drugs. The results of the initial assessment will be sent to the National Police Commission. Last month, Philippine Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos asked top police officials to submit courtesy resignations in a bid to cleanse the force of cops with links to drug trafficking. Abalos says over 900 officers will be evaluated individually.
Ang National Police Commission naman ang magre-review nito at titignan. Hindi na niya na pwedeng dagdagan yung listahan. Kundi from there, titignan, nireviewin maigi kung sino talagang tatanggapin ang resignation.
The Philippine Coast Guard urged to be more consistent in exposing China's illegal activities in the country's waters. The PCG has admitted not all incidents in the West Philippine Sea were reported to the public. But experts maintain this should not be the case, as it may just lead to more cases of harassment against Filipino sailors.
Para ma-pressure din yung kabilang party at the same time, malaman ng publiko na hindi lang minsan ito ginawa, kundi pwede ulit-ulitin pa nilang gawin ito. Otherwise, if hindi nila i-release ito at sasabihin sa publiko, China will do the same thing and do it in a harsh way.
I'm sure that there are probably several incidents that probably were a lot more tense that have still not been brought to light.
The PCG, meanwhile, reiterates the need for modernization to better respond to China's aggression. That's as it confirms the continued presence of suspected Chinese maritime militia and Coast Guard vessels in the country's waters.
We are alarmed not because of their presence. We are alarmed because they have been ignoring our diplomatic protests that we filed 2 weeks ago. The decision of filing the diplomatic protests is only decided by the DFA, sir. Our role in the Philippine Coast Guard is only to document what is happening. And from there, we inform them, use it as a reference for their decision whether a diplomatic protest will be filed or not.
The son of Philippine Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla succeeds his father as the new representative of the 7th District of Cavite. The Philippine Poll Body says Cavite board member Crispin Diego Ping Remulla garnered nearly 100,000 votes in Saturday's special elections. That's over 60% of the total number of votes cast. The congressional seat was earlier vacated after the earlier elder Remulla was appointed Justice Secretary.
It's very big shoes to fill, so I have to work really hard so I can actually help out a lot of our constituents in our district.
Last week, a delegation from the European Parliament visited the Philippines to check on the human rights situation in the country. The group says it sees a significant improvement after the term of former President Duterte, but it urges the new administration to restore the Philippines' membership in the International Criminal Court. I spoke with the head of the EU delegation, Hannah Neumann, for more on their visit. Here's that interview.
So, Hannah Neumann, thank you so much for your time with us. Let me just get your impressions first about your three-day visit here. There were some words that have been said from the Senate, coming from senators. How would you characterize the reaction so far, whether during your meetings or outside your meetings with lawmakers and other interest groups?
Well, first of all, Mike, it was three quite busy days. So we had meeting after meeting after meeting. And sometimes checking social media in between, we saw that some senators obviously used our visit for self-promotion, saying meetings were controversial or tense where there clearly hadn't been. Overall, I had the impression that there was a huge interest on both sides, amongst me and my colleagues, to better understand where this new administration is heading when it comes to human rights, but also to understand by our interlocutors, be it majority or minority in the Senate or the House, to make us understand what their plans are, but also to understand better what is important for the European Union. So it were for sure honest exchanges, but I found them to be quite constructive, and everyone clearly underlining that we can only have these honest exchanges because we have always had, and I hope we will always have, very good relationships between the EU and the Philippines.
What do you make, though, of some lawmakers insisting on Philippine sovereignty when it comes to discussions in the ICC? How do you find that argument?
Well, maybe the European Union people are not the right people to discuss about keeping sovereignty, because we have 27 very strong EU countries, including countries as big as Germany and France, that have given up a large bulk of their sovereignty to the European Union. So to make everyone work together to create synergies, save money, and make our people living in better living conditions, making more money. And all of these 27 have also given up sovereignty to the ICC because they believe in the primacy of international law. So we are really not the ones that support ideas on keeping sovereignty close to yourself.
I understand that you are reassessing the GSP Plus program and the Philippines is reapplying. Will you require rejoining the ICC as a precondition for accepting the application of the Philippines?
It is something that has been asked for by the European Parliament, and I am amongst those supporting it. We are at the moment in negotiations between the Council, so the Member States, the Commission, and the Parliament about what in the end will be the requirements. So I simply can't tell you because people are right now sitting in discussions trying to figure this out.
But what's your assessment of the GSP Plus program? Has it been effective in compelling the Philippines to at least comply with international human rights standards that it has vowed to uphold?
What it clearly has done is shown to the Philippines that it is important to us. It provides a framework under which we continuously discuss, even under the challenging presidency of Duterte, continue to discuss the importance of human rights, and it now provides us with an avenue, and this is how I hope people would see it, as an avenue to work together where the EU can also support with technical expertise and others the Philippines in implementing these standards, because in the end, I mean, they are there to support Filipinos in low-wage labor, so that for if fish has preferential trade agreement with us, we want to make sure that the people who are working well in the sea to fish this fish don't have to work 15 hours not getting any sleep under very bad working conditions. We want to make sure that the timber we buy doesn't come from areas where indigenous people have been evicted. We want to make sure that the minerals we buy doesn't come from child labor in Mindanao, you know? And this is but mostly to the benefit of the Filipino people who don't want to work under these conditions. So really, I just hope everyone doesn't see it as a competition or how much do I get for, but as a joint endeavor to make sure that everyone in the Philippines and in the other countries that have GSP Plus will soon enjoy better labor standards.
You said during the press conference that this is certainly better than the time of former President Duterte. How better off is the Philippines now under President Marcos in terms of human rights commitments? You have the Justice Secretary discussing judicial reforms and other reforms with you yesterday, and yet you still have cases of red tagging, threats against activists. Maria Ressa is still convicted under cyber libel. Senator De Lima is still detained after 6 years. ABS-CBN is still closed. Rappler still has the threat of being closed. And killings continue. So are we better off now? Is it more of the same thing? What's your assessment?
I mean, we are not a full-fledged fact-finding mission. It's impossible with five people in 3 days to basically assess all the Philippines. What we clearly see is that there is an opening to discuss these issues. I mean, with Duterte, it was a door shut. He didn't give a bit, and he made that very clear. The new administration is open to discussing. The new administration has a number of announcements made that go in the right direction. But as I said, we have to see implementation. We have to see extrajudicial killings being properly investigated and stopped. We have to have media better protected, and a lot of these media channels that had to close coming back. We have to see Senator Leila De Lima being free again. We have people who do red tagging being punished for doing that because it gets people killed. It's not just that something that you throw around. It literally gets people killed. So we are happy to support everything that goes into this direction, but it has to be done by the administration. Will they do it? Well, I don't have like the glass bulb. But let's all together make sure that we all play our part to encourage them to do it.
A final question, and this goes to all Filipinos who might be thinking, why should we listen to Europeans? Why should we listen to foreigners, especially with respect to human rights? How would you address them and tell them why is it important to adhere to human rights, basic principles of human rights?
Just ask yourself, do you want your child to be tortured? Do you want your child to be killed by someone on a motorbike because they mistake him for or her for a drug dealer? Do you want to say your opinion freely? It is something that is so foundational to each and everyone's lives that people all around the world, in the Philippines who fight for it are getting killed, in Iran who fight for it are getting killed. And it is so fundamental to make our societies work. So each and every time sometime tells you, you know, human rights is that about me, well, look at what is enshrined into the Charter of Human Rights and wonder if you want yourself or your children to live without these rights. And then I think you can easily see why it is so important that we uphold them. I can only tell you for the European Union, I mean, we come out of this horror of World War II, where people, only because they had the wrong religion, were put into gas chambers in the millions. Because we somehow didn't have that notion that every human life is valuable. And this was the darkest times. I don't want anyone to go back to that.
Hanne Neumann, thank you so much for your time with us today.
You're welcome.
The Philippine government plans to expand the targeted cash transfer program for poor families. This is in a bid to help them cope with rising inflation. The consumer price index hit a 14-year high of 8.7% in January.
We are considering a 2-month subsidy. The amount is something like 1,000. We have already identified the funding source, so we're just waiting for the announcement from the palace.
According to the finance department, the proposed expanded cash in program may cost over 9 billion pesos. Local motorists can expect a breather this week after diesel and gasoline prices went up by nearly 1 peso. Estimates show the price of gasoline per liter may go down by up to 1 peso. Diesel prices, meanwhile, may be slashed by at least 1 peso and 30 centavos.